Hello, and welcome to the VAP on ovarian cancer. My name is Taylor Turner. I'm currently a resident in obstetrics and gynecology at Duke University Medical Center. Today, we'll be discussing the topics listed here and hope to provide a 10-minute overview of the key information for a medical student concerning ovarian cancer. Ovarian cancer in its most common form originates from the ovarian epithelium, but as you know, the ovaries are complex structures with multiple unique cell types that each can form unique neoplasms. To frame this discussion, let's imagine a patient. She is a 43-year-old female who had a CT scan recently for appendicitis. Incidentally, an adnexal mass was noted. She's very concerned about this finding and is worried it could be cancer. Like many people, she has heard of the poor prognosis of ovarian cancer and wants answers. Before we talk about ovarian cancer, let's review what in the ovary could be a malignancy. Here's a quick overview of different structures within the ovary. When considering ovarian neoplasms, there are three basic sources. First, germ cell tumors from the oocyte itself. Second, sex cord stromal tumors that originate from the theca and granulosa cells that surround the developing oocyte. And third, epithelial cell tumors that are the most common. Let's look closer at the types of tumors that each source commonly forms. Germ cell tumors are more common in young women, but are a minority of total ovarian tumors. Many of you may have heard of mature teratomas, which are germ cell tumors that are the most common benign ovarian tumor and often contain developed tissues, including hair, bone, teeth, and other strange structures. Stromal tumors are a rare type that distribute across all ages. Now, if we return to our hypothetical patient, she is 43 years old, asymptomatic, and if she truly has a neoplasm, then statistically speaking, it likely originated from epithelial cells. And since today we're talking about cancer, we'll stay focused on ovarian cancer. And since the great majority of ovarian cancers are epithelial in origin, we'll focus there. But remember, there are other types of more rare ovarian tumors. But of course, not all ovarian masses are cancer. She could have an endometrioma from extrauterine endometrial tissue. She could have a physiologic cyst that will resolve on its own. So let's examine what else could be on her CAT scan before we talk more about cancer. If she truly does have some abnormal CAT scan findings on her ovary, we need to figure out exactly what it is. I've mentioned some of the other options, various types of ovarian cancers, endometriomas, benign cysts, and so on. In order to start to differentiate between them, we need to examine the findings on imaging. Small, simple cysts are very rarely malignant and are quite common in menstruating women. As cysts become more complex, larger, or more solid than cystic, all of these things raise the risk of malignancy. So let's return to our patient who's worried about cancer. As with all patients, determining individual risk involves a thorough history. Family history and age are two of the most significant risk factors in epithelial ovarian cancer. Now, having one or even a few relatives with ovarian cancer increases a woman's risk, but a much more significant risk is associated with a specific hereditary syndrome. A thorough pedigree chart helps sort out the difference. The BRCA mutations, also very important in breast cancer, play an important role in ovarian cancer risk as well. Now, please remember that while hereditary syndromes increase an individual's risk, the great majority of ovarian cancers arise sporadically. Several less significant risk factors have been observed as well, things like late menopause or nulliparity. These are easy to remember because they are associated with increased number of menstrual cycles throughout a woman's life. So a woman with early menarche and late menopause will have more cycles and a slightly increased risk of ovarian cancer. Now, our patient is asymptomatic, which unfortunately is a common presentation of ovarian cancer. Patients will often be asymptomatic until their cancer has spread to another organ and begin to affect it, i.e. the bowel, the bladder, or liver. This is why ovarian cancer has such a high mortality rate and is often found at an advanced state. A few possible symptoms are listed here, but except for an ovarian mass, they're quite vague. So while a good history is important for evaluating risks, the patient's recent symptoms are not very helpful, particularly if their cancer is early stage or small. Once diagnosed, Treatment for epithelial ovarian cancer is very aggressive. Surgical debulking via laparotomy is the standard of care. In these procedures, every visible cancerous tissue is resected, leading to very significant surgeries. These cases can last for many hours and include removal of the ovaries, uterus, appendix, omentum, partial splenectomies, and even resection of the diaphragm. Lymph node removal is also performed along with pelvic washings. In practice, virtually all patients receive adjuvant chemotherapy, but in the patient with stage 1 and low-grade ovarian cancer, surgery alone may be enough. When you look at this slide and remember what we've talked about so far, you start to understand the difficulty in diagnosing and treating ovarian cancer. Early stage disease has very optimistic 5-year survival rates, but those same tumors have very few symptoms and are often not diagnosed. Now, the staging here is presented in a very simplified fashion, but I believe it is sufficient for medical students. The important concept is one shared with many neoplasms, that once malignant cells spread far beyond their origin, they are much more difficult to treat. So when we consider our patient, a 43-year-old with an ovarian mass, her age alone makes it unlikely she has cancer, though she is nearing an age of increased risk. And there are many other things that could show up on a CAT scan, but now you have a great starting point on how to evaluate in cancer here. It starts with examining the findings on CAT scan with a closer eye, and ends with looking at her individual risk factors and her individual symptoms. My references are listed here. The images contained within this presentation are all open source. And special thanks to Dr. Elizabeth Livingston and Dr. Amy Ferrandino for help in preparing this presentation.